watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
Hi, welcome to another Journeys with Jeff. Nice to have you with us. We've been getting a lot of phone calls, and we have a young man with us today who's called in, about a month or so ago, called in and asked if he could share his journey with us. So, I'd like to introduce Mr. John McGurk. John McGurk, how are you?
Hello.
And tell us about, start off, tell us about yourself. Where are you from?
I'm from West Harvard.
And right now we're filming, we're at your house in Manchester now.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But you were born in West Hartford.
Correct.
And when how far back?
1944.
You were born in Hartford, West Hartford in 44?
Well, I was born at Hartford Hospital.
Yeah. And you were born and you were raised in West Hartford.
Yep.
And did you used to go to the Central Theater on Saturday afternoons, Saturday mornings?
Occasionally.
Remember the Saturday morning movies?
Yeah. If we were paying any attention.
Yeah. Well, did you like the you like this Central Theater?
Yeah.
And Maxwell Drugstore and...
Maxwell Drugstore. I was kind of shy. I didn't really have a lot of girlfriends yet. I was a late bloomer.
Well, when you were a young man, where'd you go to school?
Hall High.
Hall High?
Yeah, you know that.
And what before that?
Oh, you mean like...
Where'd you go to elementary school?
Well, Morley School.
To Morley?
Yep, and then to Plant.
Okay. And you lived with your parents, I assume?
Correct, yeah. Well, my father and my mother and my grandmother.
Your grandmother lived with you too?
Yeah, she, around when I was 11 years old, she moved in to help out. My mother went to the hospital.
Oh, I see. So your grandmother had a big hand in raising you, and
oh yeah, whether I liked it or not, she had a hand in it.
Your mother was like not at home for a period of time.
Well, she wasn't home most of the time. She was okay for it. She had mental illness.
Oh, I see. So was your grandmother? Would you say your grandmother was a big influence in raising you and the?
Yeah, I didn't like a lot of the stuff she did, but she did well to put up with my father and me.
Yeah. Growing young man. So, did you used to go down to when you were a little boy at Morley School?
Yeah.
When you were out of school, where did you used to like to play around? Did you ever go down to Trout Brook?
No, I used to like to. It was a church up the street. We used to play ball behind the church.
Uh huh.
Now, I during the summertime, I organized the games.
Oh, I see. Okay, but you never. Trout Brook was one of my favorite places.
Yeah.
Did you ever go there? Did you ever?
Well, I wasn't. Well,
Trout Brook was right outside your house almost.
Yeah, I know one kid would walk across the bridge. He used to walk across the bridge all the time, you know, above Trout Brook.
Yeah.
I forget who it was by name, but.
Yeah. A lot of childhood memories back then.
Yeah.
So what were some of the things that you enjoyed doing the most? What was your favorite pastime?
Oh, making trouble, but not major trouble. We used to. Can I tell the story about the bus stop?
Oh yeah, you like that story, huh?
Yeah. the landlord had a a bus stop up front. So one night I got the, it had cement all laid down, so I got that, and I moved it away. And he was kind of mad. He says, "What happened here? Where's my bus stop?" So of course I hid out for a while, and then they put the thing back, and then I did it again. I don't know how many times I did it. Hit the guy was getting pissed. But he finally says to Jeff, "Oh, I'm going to get that guy." Jeff says, "Yeah, good idea. You ought to get him."
And so you looked that you were a real prankster.
A prankster, yes.
But what was your favorite sport?
Baseball.
Were you good enough to play? Did you play on any team?
Well, yeah, I played on the Legion team.
Well, before then, you didn't just start out on the Legion team. Did you, when you were younger, did you start off in the Little League?
Every team I played on finished second.
What Little League team did you play on?
The Rotary Club.
And that was Little League, right?
Little League, yeah.
And what position did you play?
Pitcher, outfielder.
And you were good enough at it so when you got to Hall High, did you go out for the team at Hall?
Yeah.
And how'd you do there?
I didn't find that the coach sucked. The coach was a terrible coach.
Well, besides that, how did you do? Were you a good?
I hit a home run in cold weather with the ball. It tied up the game in the last inning.
Yeah.
I hit it into the trees. I was a skinny guy, but I could still generate some power.
You had a heck of a bat, huh?
Yeah, not bad.
And you pitched too?
Yeah.
And you played what field? Right field? Left field? Outfield?
Left field.
So you did that. You were a baseball. You were pretty much of a standout. You were one of the better players on the team. So that after you graduated, you actually made the Legion team, right?
Right. Not the first year I tried out. The next year.
And what position did you play?
Pitcher, outfielder.
Yeah, and I see you have this is a, from that year. It says here, Legion Player of the Year awarded to John McGurk, post 96. So, not only were you on the Legion team, but you were Player of the Year on the Legion team.
Correct.
So that's not, I mean, that's no small feat. That's pretty darn good.
There was a guy on the team, the so-called star pitcher. He got $30,000 bonus. At the time, that was a fairly big bonus.
Well, did any team scout you? Did you get scouted?
No, I got discovered by accident. They were scouting a guy from Manchester, I'm trying to think of his name, Tom Kelly, and anyway, I beat him twice. So the scout says, "I'm not sure anyway what you got, but you were good enough to beat Kelly twice."
So what team was interested in you?
Well, the White Sox a little bit.
So did they want to sign you, the White Sox?
Yeah, they threw me a little bone, you know, $5,000.
Well, I mean, you know, you're 19, 18, 19 years old. That's pretty good. That's a pretty good. But then, of course, that was during the Vietnam era.
Correct.
Before you could really get really into the baseball, get your baseball career going.
I got drafted twice in 1 year. Once by the White Sox, once by my uncle.
Yeah, Uncle Sam, huh?
Yeah, Uncle Sam, yeah.
So where'd you wind up?
Well, I played in Glens Falls.
And where did you wind up in the service when you were in the Army?
Oh, Panama.
You were in Panama.
Yep. That's why.
You have a son. You have a son. Mm-hmm. From that marriage, right?
Right.
And then, you came, what did you do? How'd you, when you got out of the service, you came back to. You moved back from Panama. You didn't stay in Panama.
No.
What did you do? You moved back here?
Yeah. Yeah. My wife didn't come back right away. She had to get her everything ready before she. I had people supporting me, and I had people telling me, you know, that I have a problem with the cultural barrier.
Yeah.
Which was true, actually. But my father did something. I'm proudest thing I was ever. I was the most proud of my father.
Well, what happened?
We went over to visit my three aunts, and the aunts were pretty cold and not receptive to the whole thing.
Well, because your wife was from Panama, Panamanian.
Anybody that wasn't the same color as them, they had them, wasn't going to make it.
Yeah.
So you could tell cold receptionists were leaving the house. So my aunt said, I forget which one it was, but something like, don't come back as long as you're with her. And my father said, and they said, matter of fact, you're disowned from the will. And my father said, you can take that will and stuff up your.
Yeah, he released.
He stuck up for me.
Stuck up for you. Wow. Well, that was back then. I mean, that was like, 50 years ago. A lot of people had that, I guess a lot of people had that mentality. So you raised a son.
Mm-hmm.
How did you wind up? Well, you and your wife split up.
Right.
How did you wind up with the kid?
I went out to California and Lord looked around for him and
what do you mean? She left and went to California with him?
She went to a few places. And I went looking for him down in North Carolina, and she had just left recently, so I flew out to California. Can't think of the name of the place. It'll come to me. But anyway, I went out there and I went up to the post and I said I was looking for this person. They said we can't give the information out. I'm not sure exactly what I said, but I convinced him to give me the address. And I went over the address, and I knocked on the door. There's a guy here at the door, and he said, "Can I help you?" I said, "Yeah, I'm looking for Myra. She's my cousin." So he went in the room to get Myra, and the guy came out. I put him to sleep. I hopped in the taxi.
Well, what do you mean you put him to sleep? did he give you? He gave you a hard time about Gary.
I wasn't really interested in discussing it.
So you put him. You punched his lights out.
Yeah.
And then what did you do? You went and got your son.
I had talked to the police first. I had told this guy what I was going to do. He said, "Well, it's not legal, but I'd probably do the same thing." So I got in the taxi and I went out to the bus station, and. I ordered a ticket for Oregon. I had some friends out in Oregon, a couple. Anyway, so trying to remember where I was. We were a few minutes from leaving, and the police came in. The guy recognized me. They had me go back to the house, and they said, "Well, do you have your marriage certificate?" And she said, "Well, she didn't have it right now, and she didn't have a period. She was still legally married to me." So we went to Oregon for a brief visit. It just went up near there. They came back to West Harbor. And I pretty much kept my eye on him every hour of the day when I first came back.
Well, who's they? Who came back to West Harbor? Who's they?
Oh, my grandmother and her grandmother, Myra, and my wife.
Oh, they came back to West Hartford, and then
to Hartford. We had a house in Hartford.
But they came back. I'm confused. They you raised Gary as a single father.
Correct. Well, I had help. I had a lady who lived up the street and watched him for a while.
Right.
He would stay with them during the weekend, and I'd take on the weekend. I really didn't know what I was going to do when I got back. I was kind of winging it.
Well, Well, where was his mother at this point? She was just out of the picture, or was she? Did she come back to Hartford?
No, she came back for one visit. She said she wanted to take Gary with her and visit. I said he's not leaving my sight.
Oh wow, right. So you're back. You're out of the service.
Yep.
And the baseball career is kind of history at this point.
Yeah, for the most part.
And you're a father. You're a single father raising a son. Mm-hmm. Well, what did you do then? You never. I mean, after you got out of high school, you didn't get a college degree.
No, actually, the lady across the street who sometimes watched Gary, she encouraged me to go back to school. I said, I got lousy grades. She said, why don't you go back and take one course and see how you like it? And I took the course. The guy teaching the course was somebody that you know, Jeff, African-American guy.
Oh, Bob Atunji.
You know, he hung around with us.
Oh, Billy Wilson.
Billy Wilson.
Yeah, Billy Wilson. Yeah.
So the course I took, he said, don't think just because you're a friend of mine, I'm going to give you a grade. You got to earn your grade.
Right.
So that was a bit of a challenge.
Well, so how did you make out? How did you do it with that challenge?
Like I got an A in that course.
Okay.
I was not an A student, maybe a B student. But
did you get your degree?
I got a 2-year degree, and then I transferred to Central and finished up with a 4-year degree in special education.
So you wound up going to Central Connecticut State University.
Yes.
And you got your degree there in what?
Special education.
Okay, so you became an educator.
Yeah.
And where were you? What city? Where'd you go to? Where we?
I got a job in Hartford at Corporate Middle School. That was pretty tough as far as. I think at first your teacher should have somebody to mentor them to help them along, but I was pretty much on my own. And the guy who was evaluating me was not a special educator. He was a vice principal. He didn't know squat about special education.
Yeah. So you don't think you got the support, the mentoring that you...
No, not at all.
That would have helped. Yeah, wow.
It was tough.
And then, what was it like to be a special education teacher in Hartford? What was that like? Was that challenging?
Oh, yeah. It was tough. It was really tough. But when I got out of teaching after 1 year. After that first year, I got out of teaching, and I went back subbing later. About what year did I go back? About 10 years later. Anyway, I went back and started subbing, and I was actually a lot better teacher than just from the experience I had had, and I think I had a way with kids.
A lot of your subbing was long-term subbing, so...
Yeah, just long-term subbing.
So you get into a position and you'd be there for weeks, months even.
Yeah, sometimes till the end of the year.
Yeah. Wow.
It's very tough when you're doing that because you have to walk on eggshells. You can't piss anybody off, or, you know, they'll complain to they'll complain to people about what you're doing. You have no protection, as you know.
Well, meanwhile, your son is growing up and getting big.
Yeah.
You started to experience some dizziness and stuff. I mean, you were a veteran, so you were having some difficulty with losing your balance and stuff at some point?
No, I was having difficulty because I was fooling around with, I did some drinking. I was fooling around with drugs.
Okay. All right. Well, that's, you know, that certainly is not uncommon for back in the 60s and 70s and those days, it was not uncommon. Yeah. But wasn't there some point where you had some, you began to feel dizzy and stuff like that? You had trouble with your balance?
Well, that's after I went into the hospital, and when I came out, I was basically dizzy. I'm basically dizzy 24/7, except for when I'm sleeping.
So now, mobility wise, you're not in a wheelchair.
No.
But you need a walker when you get around.
So I need a walker when I get around. Not in the house, but most places I go, I need the walker.
Yeah, yeah, and of course you're not teaching. You're living now with your son.
Yep.
And you have a daughter-in-law.
And
you have a granddaughter.
And a
grandson. So how's life at this stage of the game? How's life?
How's it treating me?
Yeah, you feeling pretty good?
I figure I'm on borrowed time. Whatever. I'm on bonus time.
Bonus time?
Yeah, I was almost cashing my chips without realizing it.
Yeah, right.
My son and his wife actually found me I was in a bad state.
What is it that you suppose? What was it that caused you to go down that rough road, as it were?
Well, I worked for the post office, and some guy. I work at midnights, and everybody, almost everybody in there, either they smoke or they cheat on their wife or something. Everybody was doing zigging and zagging, as they say, zigging and zagging.
But I mean, is there something from earlier? Do you think that certain events in your early in your life were influenced, we all have some influences, bad influences and good influences. Do you think that the root of some of these things that you got into were, go back to earlier experiences in life?
Well, my father was an alcoholic. I didn't even know what alcoholism is.
So that was a difficult time for you?
Oh yeah.
So you got your child, you're growing up, and you've got, your mother is not around, your grandmother's raising you, you've got issues with school, and you probably weren't that great of a student, right? And you were playing sports, and you went into the service, and I mean, what would you say was the most difficult period for you, the most difficult obstacle for you?
Well, when I did have my son, when I was looking for my son,
that was
everybody told me you're wasting your time, you're not gonna find him.
Yeah.
Well, I did find him.
You're really really determined to do that.
Yep.
And do you have any? I mean, looking back, I'm sure that you're not unlike most people. You look back down the road, there have been a lot of bumps and ups and downs and stuff. Are there any disappointments? I mean, anything that you would like to do over again?
Oh, sure.
What would you do over again if you had a second chance?
If I realized I was an alcoholic, or an addict, I could have dealt with some of those issues.
Right. So
we didn't even realize it, when you're going through it.
And what's your biggest? What would you say is your biggest accomplishment in life?
Well, raising my son.
And he turned out to be a good kid. He's working. He's raising two kids.
I'm very proud of him. He overcame cigarette smoking. And he overcame his addiction.
Uh-huh.
He's been straight for quite a while now.
And he had to fight some of his stuff. So do you think there are a lot of people out there who've had to face their adversities because of there's reasons behind it.
Yeah, but it doesn't really matter what the reason is. It has to be dealt with. If you want to reverse things, you have to deal with it.
Yeah. So no matter, in other words, whatever happened early on in life, whatever slings and arrows of outrageous fortune what were inflicted upon you, it's really, at some point, you got to take responsibility for that.
As well put.
Yeah. Okay. All right, very good. Well, thank you. Very good. That was very. That's a very touching, pretty poignant story. But a heck of a trip along the way. Well, we have John's son Gary has graciously agreed to just talk to us for a second. Gary McGurk.
Yes.
Over there. There you go. Thanks for joining us. And you had a few things to say that you wanted to fill in. You said that when you were that little baby,
yep,
your father came to get you. Where was it in California?
Monterey, I believe.
Monterey?
Yes.
And tell us about you said you came across some papers that your father, but tell us about your father.
I can't recall.
Father's military.
Discharge.
Yeah, he was in charge of protecting the West Coast, but I think he was a sniper or a marksman. What else were you?
Marksman, yeah, I was in charge of. Oh, yeah, we were in charge of protecting the West Coast. But
yeah, he was. His job title was a missile launcher or something like that. He would launch the missiles if they were.
If we were threatened.
Yeah, yeah, basically.
One time I came within like 30 seconds of firing. It got down range, and whoever it was didn't identify themselves. And finally, just at the last second, they identified themselves.
And you almost
blew them to smithereens.
You were almost, yeah. What were you? What kind of a weapon did you have? M14.
No, we had a missile launcher.
A missile launcher. Oh my God!
But he was an excellent marksman, though.
Wow.
Yeah. But I got maybe sometime I can show you guys the paperwork. What
was he? What did you think? Was he? With all the difficulties that he had to deal with so many difficulties in his life. How was that being brought up and being his son? It had some of its difficulties for you too, right? But now that you look back, did he do a good job?
Yeah.
Did the best he could?
The best he could, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. My wife. Yeah, he did the best he could.
Well, the important thing is that did you feel then, do you know now, that given his own issues, and anybody who has been raised by parents, I don't care who they are,
right,
have all come into adulthood with some of their own issues.
Right.
But did you feel that, and do you feel that he genuinely did care about you and loved you?
Oh, of course, yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That counts for a lot.
We have a good bond, me and my dad, we're good friends. For the most part, we have my dad's my back. My dad always had my back, for the most part.
Right.
Yep. So the only person I really trust is my dad.
It's good. Very good. Okay, well, thanks, Gary. Thanks for taking a couple of minutes and joining us.
No problem.
We appreciate that.
No problem.
I want to say goodbye to everybody out there. Thank you for watching. And do what John did. If you're interested, call up the TV station. Or send us an email if you'd like to come and tell us a little bit about your journey. We'd be very happy to hear from you. And thanks again. Bye-bye.